But I really hope that you've enjoyed this week of sun that we've had. I don't know, maybe you've had some time to take off work and just go down to the beach in an evening and enjoy it. Or maybe you've been finished your exams at school and you've just been able to go for a swim or have an ice cream at a friend's house. Or maybe it's just been a bit too hot for you and you're just so glad it's finally over. I think that is our summer over. I don't know about you guys. I think that is finished. Maybe that's just me being pessimistic, but I hope you made the most of it. One of the things that we obviously look forward to in our younger years in summer is the classic sports day. I don't know if that's happened for you yet. Maybe you're here and you have just had your very own moment of egg and spoon race at your local school, or maybe it's coming up in a few weeks. But to me, sports day really highlights the kind of peak of school summer. Just moments in the sun with your friends, running, limbs flailing everywhere. You don't really know what's happening, but you get a medal for giving it your best shot anyway. Parents are lining up along the field, trying to get that magical moment of their kid looking a bit like this somewhere, maybe taking a video. And there is one video I just want to show of a parent who does exactly that, tries to capture their kid's magical moment on sports day. So if we could just play that.
Hello.
Isn't that such a great video? I just love, there's so many things I love about that video. The amount of adults that seem to need to run after this little kid, why they didn't take the shortcut, I don't know. Maybe they need some lessons in how shapes and lengths work. But I think we could learn a lot from that little kid as well. But one of the other big, big highlights for me this summer has to be the Paris 2024 Olympics. I don't know if you guys get as excited about this for me, but it seems to be. Thank you for the whoop about the Olympics. It's just an incredible chance where the world gets to partake in the sports together. London 2012 was 12 years ago. Can you believe it? There's a new sport this year as well, breakdancing. I don't know how we feel about that. Kieran, I know you've just taken 3 months off to go on sabbatical. There's still a chance for you to get in the Olympics. I don't know if you could give this a go. But yeah, it certainly feels like the Olympics is a pinnacle of world sport every 4 years. And Paris gets the joy of hosting that this year. At London 2012, the last event that happened was the 4x100 meter relay. I don't know if you guys remember it. Maybe you weren't born. Maybe you are old enough to remember where you were when Jamaica smashed that world record. To help us get into the spirit of what a pinnacle and what a moment this was for Team Jamaica, we actually got it on the screen just to get us in the flavor of the Olympics.
And a very good run by the American Trout Kimmons. He's gone very strongly indeed. Now then, the Jamaicans have got it served, the Americans, and Gatlin's made a bit of headway down the back straight there, and it's USA from Jamaica at the moment. Very, very strong indeed, but here goes the a Jamaican changeover was terrific, and all of a sudden you've got Tyson Gay versus Johan Blake, and Blake's winning this one, and here comes Usain Bolt. He has the baton, and it's Bolt versus Ryan Bailey, and Usain Bolt is moving away, and Jamaica retain their title, 36.85, and the world record has been taken apart. Oh, I say, what a way to finish an Olympic game.
Wow. I got flashbacks to London 2012 and my mind went to some places of what I was doing then, but it's just incredible to see a world record get smashed. I wonder this year if someone will break that. But you may be here just wondering why we're looking at sports day, why we're looking at relays. Well, the Bible, I think, is fairly clear that the Christian life is like that of a race. Paul writes, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And there's another verse that says, let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. And so when you hear these verses, I don't know what sort of race you imagine. Maybe it's a marathon, running with perseverance. Never done one, but I understand you need a lot of perseverance to do a marathon. Or maybe you think of it as a sprint, kind of your own race you need to run. But if the Bible is saying it is a race as a Christian life, surely this would be more like a relay than a sprint. 100-meter sprints like the one up there are all about getting your head down, staying in your own lane, and running your own race. But I think if you look at the biblical overview, the kind of narrative of what the Bible is, it isn't about staying in your lane, focus on yourself, making sure that you are running your own race. It's about living in such a way that you are passing something on from one generation to another. The Bible is full of verses about this as well, mostly in Psalms. Psalm 145 says, one generation commends your work to another. They tell of your mighty acts. Psalm 71 says, even when I am old and gray, do not forsake me, my God, till I declare your power to the next generation, your mighty acts to all who are to come. Psalm 78 says, we will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power and the wonders he has done, so that the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children. And in Joel, we hear, tell it to your children, and let your children tell it to their children, and their children to the next generation. These are just a few that I've found as I was prepping. There's so many other verses about passing something from one generation to the next. And if we look at people in the Bible, it's a continuing theme. We have Moses to Joshua, David passes on to Solomon, Elijah passes something to Elisha, Jesus with his disciples. But the one I really want to focus in on today is Paul and Timothy. For those who don't know, Paul was a key Christian leader in the early church. He was raised as a Jew, but he had a radical encounter with Jesus. And from that moment, he basically spent his life traveling from town to town, telling people the good news about Jesus. Timothy, we know less about, but we know his mother was a Jew and his father was that of a Greek. And we read about them meeting in Acts chapter 16. And it says, Paul came to Derbe and then to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived, whose mother was a Jewish believer, but whose father was a Greek. The believers at Lystra and Iconium spoke well of him, and Paul wanted to take him along the journey, so he circumcised him because of the Jews who lived in that area, for they all knew his father was a Greek. As they travelled from town to town, they delivered the decisions reached by apostles and elders in Jerusalem for the people to obey. So the churches were strengthened in faith and grew daily in numbers. So what we see in these verses is Paul seeing something in Timothy and wanting to bring him along on the journey together. He knew that part of his own story couldn't be fulfilled unless he handed over some churches and some places to Timothy. He couldn't do this by himself, and so he chose to invite Paul from an early age, we think about 16, 17, to start this journey together. They spent around 20 years on this journey of gospel spreading. And at the end, in a book called 2 Timothy, which is his last letter to Timothy, Paul basically writes down everything he wants Timothy to kind of get, remember, take hold of before that is the end of their journey together. And it says, you know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you have learned it. Keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, and discharge all the duties of your ministry. Paul is saying, you've learned from me. You've been with me for years. You know what my way of life is. You know what makes me tick. You know how I am as a person, in public, in private. Remember that and continue my leg for me. Don't get too busy thinking about yourself, but remember to discharge all forms of your ministry. This could, I think, be saying in other ways to say, fulfill all your ministry. And what is that ministry we're talking about? The Great Commission, to go and make disciples in all nations. Well, to make disciples must mean something about handing something over to that next generation. And at the end, Paul is so confident in who Timothy has become. He actually writes to another church in a place called Philippi and says, I have no one else like him who will share genuine concern for your welfare. Everyone looks out for their own interests, not those of Jesus. But you know that Timothy has proved himself, because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. And for the remainder of the time together, I just want to look at three very quick lessons I think we can learn and try and get hold of from the life of Paul and Timothy. The first lesson I think we need in passing something on is to have intentional proximity. Some big fancy words, but what I basically mean is Paul made a decision to invest in Timothy at an early age. We need a church full of people who are choosing to invest in the next generation, who are going out of their way to help them, to raise them, to grow them, just like what we've heard from these guys up here, so we have the next generation ready to run their leg. Timothy gets named in 11 of 13 of Paul's letters together. He's thought to help him write 6 of them, and they spent so much time together traveling from Greece and Macedonia, Athens. So there must have been something valuable in what they had. They would have argued together, laughed together, eaten together, prayed together, maybe had some big theological debates, maybe some small ones about some football score, if that happened back though. I don't know. Maybe they were rival football supporters. But one thing we do know is that Timothy has spent so much time that Paul says, you know my way of life. I wonder how many of us today have people that know our way of life. I'm not sure I could hold my hands up and say many people know what I'm like every moment of the day, what my rhythms of life are, how I am in public, how I am at home. Maybe you do, and that's great, but I think the challenge for us is we need people who know what our way of life is, and you can get to a stage where you can say, I can't go, but I've got somebody who is exactly like me who will fulfill that for me, just like Paul and Timothy. Our second opportunity and lesson, I think, is we need to have intentional opportunity. There is no point learning and watching another generation pick stuff up if you don't get a chance to do it yourself. We have young people crying out for opportunities to lead, to serve, and they want to be passed the baton. Are we willing as a church to give that opportunity to them? Timothy was 16 when he met Paul, and from a early age was given that opportunity to deliver something of what Paul was saying to the churches themselves. It wasn't kind of bring your kid to work day where they sat in a corner given an iPad or a stone tablet in those days maybe, or a puzzle book and told, shh, I need to concentrate on the hard stuff. Can you just keep yourself busy? You're kind of here with me, but not. No, Timothy was at the heart of what Paul was doing from 17, 18 years old. There's a stat that says next year, 73% of our workforce will be aged between 18 and 25, but only 24% will be in a managerial position. I think as a society, we need to start trusting those young people. They are after authenticity, not professionalism. They are after deep relationships, not surface ones. I think we have such a great opportunity here at King's to provide them with deep, genuine, authentic relationships for them to help grow and lead. In 1 Corinthians and Philippians, Paul describes Timothy as a brother. He says in Philemon, Paul, a prisoner of Jesus and Timothy, who is our brother. And elsewhere in Hebrews, it says, I want you to know that our brother Timothy has been released. Talking about being released from prison there, I think. But in those times, a brother is somebody who worked alongside you, who grafted with you. It wasn't a kind of father-son relationship where one is watching the other learn. It is about getting alongside each other and doing life together. Some of the disciples, as you may know, were fishermen together. They kind of carried this ownership. And so I think what Paul is trying to say is the relationship hasn't just stayed at this kind of father-son watching, but has moved into Timothy is my brother, he is my equal, he is my co, please listen to him. He carries as much weight as I do. They weren't waiting for kind of the big dog Paul to turn up. They were ready to learn from Timothy because they understood what that was. In fact, they became so alike that in the letter to Corinth, Paul says, "Therefore, I urge you to imitate me. And for this reason, I have sent you Timothy, my son whom I love, who is faithful in the Lord. He will remind you of my way of life in Jesus, which agrees with everything I have taught in every church." And so Paul is saying, if you want to imitate me, Timothy is here, ready, teach, learn from him, learn from him. It's better that Timothy is here than me myself. It's almost like a kind of the same reflection in the mirror. When Paul looks in the mirror, Timothy is the one being shown there. And again, I wonder in our own lives, do we have people that are like that? Do we have another generation coming up that are so ready to take on our spiritual gifts, our prophetic words, our style of leadership, our discipleship, that we can say, actually, it's great, you are now ready to take on where I am. I will reduce and you can increase in the leadership here. And finally, the last lesson that I think we can look at is about intentional legacy. I started off by showing you that video of the relay. We looked at the Jamaica relay, and I think most people here are familiar that the most important part of a relay race isn't about how you start the sprint or even about how Usain Bolt can take it home, but it's about the handover of the baton. When I was in sports days, I basically used it as a chance to skip some lessons. So me and my friends would kind of sit on this grassy bank and just watch the entire day, probably silently judging those who are taking part. I'll hold my hands up. We quite like to do that. But what was fascinating is watching the relays prep in the afternoon. They would spend half an hour, 45 minutes, and the teachers would be barking instructions at them of, make sure you say the word, make sure you say the word, make sure your hand is out like that picture there. And they just practiced time and time and time again until they thought they had got it as good as they can. And what really showed through was the ones who practiced that were the ones later on in the finals who would win the race. If they knew, if they got that moment right, a victory was coming. If they didn't get that right, chances are they might drop the baton or not get home in the gold medal. And I think, again, that is something, says something to us of what the Christian life is about. Are we practicing, are we ready practicing that handover to the next generation? Here's a slow-mo, or slightly slow-mo video of that Jamaican third leg, which commentators say probably gave them not only the victory, but the world record in the end.
When they come in, look at that, they have this sprint start situation. Hand goes out, perfect, that's lovely. That is what it's about, that's what it's about.
Just a short video. I don't know if anyone else picked it up, but the commentator's like, that is lovely. That's what it's all about. And I joke, but isn't that true of what the Christian life is? Like, it's all about handing something on to the next generation. Otherwise, King's Church Mid-Sussex isn't going to have that legacy that we've heard about Newday. If Newday wasn't passing something on from the kind of token old people to the guys who are coming up, it wouldn't have lasted 20 years. The reason Newday is so good at what it's doing is because it's creating an environment for youth leaders to pass something on to our next generation. If I just want to talk to some people in the room today. If you are, as our psalmist says, old and grey, firstly, you don't know how lucky you are. I am not going to have the chance to go old and grey, okay? You have something, so please do not complain about hair growing old or slightly hair thinning, okay? But on a serious note, you have a legacy. You have something to pass on to the next generation. That doesn't necessarily mean the year sevens in the room, or it could do. It could just be about passing something on to the generation ahead of you or two generations ahead of you. You have something so, so important to pass on to the next generation. And I would encourage you to think about who you are doing that with. Who are you passing on your answered prayer stories to? Who are you passing on your experiences of the Holy Spirit, or how this church started, if you are part of the house church that started this? The unfortunate nature of what I'm talking about today is a Canadian theologian called D.A. Carson writes, "One generation believes something, the next assumes it, and the third will forget and deny it. And that is from some studies that they have taken some data of. I just want to challenge us today. How sad would that be if that is our story in this church? How sad if we have one generation who fought for what the King's Church Mid-Sussex is. We are now probably in a generation that are using all that amazing benefits of what they have given us. How sad would it be if the generation coming up forget and deny what this church has been built on? It is so, so, so important that we have a generation who are ready, keen and eager to hand that baton on to the next generation and invest in them. I would love to see stories and hear stories of how that has happened in this church and what incredible ways God has used that over the coming months. But equally important, it's not just about the person handed over the baton. It's as important as the person receiving it. We need a generation who is starting to run their race. If you are in that kind of younger age, 20s, 30s, teens today, I would encourage you, think about how you are starting to run your leg of the race. Think about how your arm is stretched out, metaphorically saying, we're ready, give pass the baton on, we're ready. We are so keen to take over from you. We have watched you, we have learned everything there is to know about you. Please trust us as we get ready to move forward in this. Opportunities to serve, to lead. I know we have a fantastic team of servers in this church who are under 18 already. Right now, there are some kids' works going on. I know a bunch of our own youth are out there serving them. And that is something about passing from one generation to the next. This isn't just some good theory or some hopefully encouraging and engaging words from me. This is actually part of my own story. Jim, when I was 17, invited me to do a year out here. I started running. I started running my leg. I set chairs up. I helped pack up the toddler groups. That's so fantastic that we run. We used to host massive alpha launches. I was in the kitchen washing up. I was cleaning toilets. I was doing whatever I could to serve this church. And I learned a lot. It was hard work. Hopefully, Jim, Tim, Kieran, Steve, I grafted okay. I would like to think I was a help, not a hindrance. But I learned something about the local church in that year. And actually, a few years after doing that, Tim invited me to join him on what's become a slightly infamous trip to Haiti. This was a chance for that intentional proximity I was chatting about earlier, a chance for Tim, who is the generation above me, to invest and see something in me. We learned a lot, we laughed a lot, probably mainly at my own expense. If you want more information, head to Tim at the end of the service. I'm sure he'll helpfully delve into some of the videos that have been filmed of me doing some piano playing in Haiti. That's all I'm saying. But it was the start of such a really good friendship, and I'm so grateful for Tim, who's invested in me over the years. I don't think I would be here if it wasn't for Jim and Tim when I was 17, invited me to do the year out in Haiti here. But it's not just them, it's not just big things. There have been so many people, and I could list them, who have invested in me over the years. Whether that is inviting me over just to watch a football game, if that has been games of golf, breakfast, dinners, drinks out to see how I'm doing, board game evenings, walks. It doesn't have to take much, but what I valued so, so, so much is the idea of someone older than me wants to see how I'm doing. To see those kind of generational barriers break down. And yeah, I can safely say I wouldn't be here on the stage talking to you guys if it isn't for 7, 8, I don't know, people in this church who just continually, monthly checked in on how I was doing. Who challenged me, who, as Mari said, who let me go deeper in my faith and kind of question things, ask those tough questions, go through that kind of learning stage you need to do when you're 17, 18. If we don't have that opportunity, we're going to have a 17, 18-year-olds that have all these questions, but no one to turn to. This is what our vision is for our church. We long for our life groups to be genuinely intergenerational. We long for young people to be part of our worship team, our tech team, our hosting team, refreshments, car parking. We want this church to be a family. And as a family, don't we do most things together? We kind of share the load amongst us, having the slightly more mature people help and nurture and take those young ones under their wing. I would love us as a church to hear so many stories of how that has happened, of how we have helped young people get through the tough circumstances in their life, of how we have helped them learn how to prophesy, how we have helped them learn what spiritual gifts are, who the Holy Spirit is, and how he can help in your life, of young people praying for healings for other people and that coming true, for just intergenerational church. So how can we make this a bit more practical in the closing few minutes? Firstly, I'd encourage you to pray. If the only thing that you take from this talk is to pray for the next generation, I think I've done my job well. We know so much the power of prayer in our own lives. I don't know how many of here are sat here today because someone from another generation prayed for them to be here today. I know that's my own story. I know there's others in this church who are sat here as a direct result of somebody older or younger than them praying that they would come to know Jesus. Whether that is kids praying for their parents to come to church because they've loved the kids' work, or if that is grandparents praying for their grandkids. After I finished, I'm going to encourage you guys on the way out, if you are prepped and ready to give, there is that opportunity as well, and I'll run through that in a minute. But we have got some names, first names of kids who are coming to Newday as part of our youth group. I would love to see us take those names and own that in prayer. I would love to know that every single person, the youngest to the oldest in our youth group, is being prayed for to encounter Jesus in some way at Newday this year. Please do. Don't just take one or just take as many as you want and commit to praying for them for that week. There are some small cards. If you're not sure how to do that, there are some small cards just to give you some top tips and some prayer points. But please do take them and use them. Secondly, get involved in our youth work and kids work. Young people are crying out for an older generation, people who are older than them, to notice them, to love them, to encourage them, and to equip them. We have so many myths on what it takes to be a youth worker in church nowadays. People discount themselves for all sorts of reasons. If you are sat here today and you can ask a kid, how has your week been? That is all you need for our youth work. All a young person wants is for somebody older than them to notice them. If I had more time, I'd show you some studies to back this up. But do genuinely please trust me and believe me. It's what I wanted. It's what the kids want. It's just somebody to notice them. We need those role models, those spiritual brothers, those spiritual fathers, mothers, granddads, grandparents, great-grandparents, aunts, uncles in their lives. They need to know when life gets tough, I can turn to someone and I know who that person is. And lastly, if you are able to, you can give to our New Day Gift Day. We've heard so encouragingly from those people who have been to New Day, who are looking forward to New Day, what difference that can make to somebody running their leg of their race. It can be a great way to kickstart it, or it can be a great way for them to leave the kind of age bracket of New Day ready to go into kind of the real world, university, apprenticeships, work, whatever that is. If you are able to help and you have come prepared to do so, there are some envelopes on your chairs. I'd encourage you to fill them out. There are some red balloons by the doors on your way out. Please do give into that. We're also going to be taking up the offering for this next week as well. So if you haven't come but you'd like to give, there is a way to do so next week. I'm going to invite Agrippa and Fortune just to pray for us, to pray for New Day up in a minute. But before I do, I'd just love to say this has been, I've really enjoyed having this opportunity to chat to you guys today about passing something on. Please, please, please don't let this be some theoretical thing or discount yourself from doing so. Please do get involved. Please, if you are running a life group, today you could invite a 17, 18-year-old into that. We need the 17, 18-year-olds probably aren't going to take that risk themselves, and that is why it's the older person is handed it on to someone else. So if you are in a life group and you have space, why don't you invite one of our 17, 18-year-olds into that life group? 17, 18, 20-year-olds, why don't you take a massive step of faith and go and chat to somebody who is in a different generation and ask them if you have space in your life group for them? Have a chat to our leaders amongst us about if there are ways that you can play your part in our church, serving, getting alongside each other. Invite someone out for breakfast. Chat to someone over a drink. But please, pass on your leg of your race to someone else.